All right, it's 10 a.m. It's time to get going. We're on the dot. Hey, everybody. It's good to see you again. I'm going to keep this short so Royce has time. But let me introduce you to Dr. Royce Kimmons, who is an associate professor of instructional psychology and technology at BYU. Royce got his doctorate at the University of Texas. He has won way too many awards for me to even pretend like I can list them. But Royce is one of these few people that you will meet in your life who actually is making change. And he'll talk about how he's doing that today. I can tell you from my experience with working with Royce my experience in our field of study that we share together, Royce is a highly respected researcher and teacher, but more importantly, Royce is a good guy and everybody loves Royce. I'm really excited for him to talk to us today. I was fortunate enough to hear what I'm sure was a version of this last week at another conference. I told him afterwards that it was probably the best keynote I've ever heard. Really made me think, and I think that you're all going to enjoy his presentation. So, with that said, Royce, it's yours.
Great. Thank you so much. Thank you all for this invitation. Thanks, John, for that really generous introduction. And yeah, John, it's going to be pretty much what you heard earlier. So if you start nodding off, that's understandable. Let me share my screen. All right, I can't see you anymore when I do that. Okay, I can't see you. Could you verbally tell me that if you can see that?
I don't see a shared screen, Royce.
Okay, let me try again.
Okay. Now we can see it.
I can see it now. Yeah.
Perfect. And I can see you. So I was just doing something wrong. So thank you again so much. I'm super excited to talk with you. So my really grandiose title for this is here. And I think that, I like to make my titles grandiose, both to kind of set a high bar for myself, but also, I guess more importantly, so I'm in the field of educational technology, and often in our field, we get distracted by shiny things. We start talking about AR or VR or iPads or AI, and we lose sight of what we're actually trying to do. And at the end of the day, we're trying to affect educational change. And educational problems are social problems. And so the solutions to educational problems are not shiny things. The solutions are social solutions. And so in part, I try to set my scope really large for a presentation like this because it keeps me hopefully grounded and focused on what is most important. And so by the end of this, hopefully I can start to chip away at this topic. But yeah, this is nothing else. It's to help keep me on track and make sure that I'm saying things that are valuable. So this is me and my family. We live here in Provo, Utah. As John said, I have degrees from University of Texas, Southern Oregon, BYU. I used to be a faculty member at the University of Idaho, and I was a postdoc at the University of Texas. I used to be a high school teacher and a full-time mentor for at-risk kids. And so I do a lot of work in K-12 schools. And so just a few years ago, when I was living here in Provo, I was doing some work at a K-12 school. And between sessions, I was just making small talk with an admin there. And she asked me very innocently, so did you always know you wanted to be a professor? And I didn't even think about it. There was no forethought or anything to this. But my knee-jerk response to her was, of course not. That's only something that rich, smart people do. And that kind of ended the conversation. She didn't know what to say. But as I reflected on that afterwards, I started to realize just how deeply kind of my background had shaped kind of the way that I saw the world and in two kind of key ways. First of all, I think growing up and throughout my college experience, I very much saw the world in terms of people had differential possibilities or opportunities available to them in terms of ultimate careers, in terms of ultimate what they would be able to achieve in life. And that was based upon your socioeconomic status. And so I didn't see myself as someone who could, for instance, be a professor. You might as well ask me, like, do you want to go to the moon someday? It just doesn't make sense. But also the scarier part of that was that I internalized it. I internalized it to think the fact that I did not see myself in a socioeconomic position to be able to be a professor. I also internalized that to mean that I wasn't smart enough or I wasn't good enough. I took my socioeconomic status as an indicator or a, I guess, yeah, as an indication of my own internal abilities and so forth. And so I share this with you because I never really would talk about my background at all with people before this, because my background I felt was very shameful. But I'm going to share this with you because I think it's something that's helpful for what we're talking about. So this is me when I was a kid. I grew up in very rural Texas. Here in this picture, I'm sitting in my mom's lap. My Nana is there in the background. She had the most education of anyone that I know of in my extended family. She had some, she was called the Kelly girl. So she had some post-secondary training to be a secretary. And so she was a secretary for much of her life. My mom went to the University of Houston for, I think, a semester and then dropped out. But then ultimately, so I was the fourth of nine kids. And I ended up being the first to graduate from college from my extended family. Down here in the bottom right, this is the six of us sitted there. This is in a camping trailer we were living in at the time. That table folds down into a bed, and the six of us would share that bed. And not all the kids were potty trained. We didn't have running water. So it was a difficult situation in many ways. But then I went to college. And when I went to college, a lot of the kind of views of the world that I had went with me. So here are just a couple of experiences that happened at college. This is a picture of what we call DT field at the time. I loved to play football. And so at college as a freshman, I was out playing football with some friends, and I got tackled and I fell on my arm and I broke it. Well, I assumed that I broke it. I never went to the doctor. Instead, what I did is I got a long sleeve shirt and I made a sling out of it. And I would hide it under my a plaid coat or plaid pullover. I didn't actually have a coat. And so that no one would ask questions. And I just go to class like that and, never got it looked at or anything like that. And the reason for that was that, I wasn't scared of doctors, but I was scared of doctors' bills. Later, this is a picture of the Wilk Center, which is the student center at BYU. One of the places on campus where I passed out at one point because I was literally starving myself to death. I my mentality was that, I have to, afford books, tuition, and these kinds of things. And so that cost has to come from somewhere, and I have to make up the difference. And so part of how I would make up the difference is I would skip meals regularly. And then one last experience was when I started to hang out with my wife-to-be, Tori, the first dance that we went as a group, and she forgot her wallet, her purse, and so she didn't have the entrance fee. And so, I just paid the entrance fee for it, $5 or $6 or something like that. And she hates the story now because she didn't know what was going on in my life. She didn't know the situation that I was in. And so she didn't really think much of it. Oh, this nice guy, he's, paying my way. But for me, that was several days of food that I, gave up. And that's just what you did. And you wouldn't tell anyone that that was the situation that you were in. And so I share this with you not to elicit sympathy or anything like that, or even to suggest, because I know that I have students that face much more difficult trials than I have in life and struggles in this regard and others. But I share this because my situation is not unique and we just don't talk about these things very much, but it's important to talk about them and to be aware of them. Temple University does an annual study where they look at food insecurity and other needs that college students have. And they have found that almost about 42% of our students have been housing insecure in the prior 12 months. Whenever I ask educators, do they know of any of their students who are living out of their cars? They pretty much always say yes. 12% of our students have experienced homelessness in the past 12 months. And food insecurity among our students is about a third of them are experiencing food insecurity. Some estimates places closer to 40%. And this is not a regional thing. Here at BYU, we've done studies here, and we find that these numbers are pretty accurate. About a third of our students at BYU experience food insecurity. And there's also some evidence that these rates may be roughly doubled for students of color. And so this does not impact all students equally. First-gen students are much more susceptible to these things. Now, this is important for a lot of reasons. It's important to understand from a humanitarian perspective, but it's also very important to understand from a learning perspective, because this is Maslow's hierarchy of needs. And Maslow's hierarchy basically says that you cannot meet the needs of a learner. You cannot meet the needs of someone to help them, for instance, learn fractions if there are bombs going off outside of their class. This is the reason that we have things like school lunches and school breakfast, because we found that if a kindergarten student comes to school without having eaten in 18 hours, then they're not going to be able to focus on learning. Most of the learning objectives that we have for our students at every level of education are at this higher part of Maslow's hierarchy. And so if our students are not getting adequate sleep or food, or they don't feel safe, that prevents them from being able to learn the things that we want them to learn, be able to focus on learning. So there are at least four types of socioeconomic divisions that influence learning opportunities. So our students have differential access to resources necessary for life, things like food and shelter. They also have differential access to time for learning. So like when I was in high school, I worked after school to help provide for the needs of my family. I just found out my younger sister, she got her first job when she was 14. I don't even know how that's legal, but she did it. And the reason was that she was involved in sports. And when she would go to these sporting events, she wanted to be able to buy food while she was at those sporting events, like everybody else did. So she got a job just to be able to do that. People also have differential access to skilled teachers, mentors, and tutors. And we have differential access to learning materials, tools, and content. And so the kind of wicked reality of these is they're also interconnected. So if I don't have sufficient resources for food, if I don't have sufficient food, for instance, then I'm going to have to go get another job, and that's going to limit my time for learning and so forth. So that's a bad thing, but it's also a good thing, meaning that if we can make inroads into any of these, we can potentially influence the others as well. And so as I look at this list, I think about as an educator, what do I have power over? What I have difficulty really doing much, moving the needle on providing my students with food or shelter. But this last one is very much in my power as an educator. I can really have an influence on affecting learning materials and giving my students access to learning materials. So in the US, current studies show that students on average spend about $105 per textbook that they purchase. And on average, students spend about $1,200 a year on textbooks at four-year institutions. And so this is across the entire US. It varies from place to place, but you can imagine, I mean, some people look at these numbers and they think, oh, that's not a big deal. If I'm paying $40,000 a year for tuition at Harvard, that's not much, right? Well, maybe, but also a lot of things to consider with that. But also these numbers are especially problematic for things like community colleges, where this actually often students end up spending more on textbooks than they even spend on tuition. But in addition to that, there are also lots of university resources being channeled to academic publishing services that students aren't directly paying as textbooks, but they're paying for as tuition. So for instance, a mid-sized library will spend about $4 million a year on access to databases to gain access to, these $50 journal articles, for instance. And that actually ends up being libraries' biggest expense. As far as I know, that's the biggest expense that libraries tend to have, other than personnel. So this is a problem also because academic publishing is deeply restrictive. So this picture on the left is an article I wrote, one of the articles that I've written that I'm proud of. There are some articles I've written that I hope no one ever reads, but this one I hope people read. And I got it published in a really good journal. I got it published in Teachers College Record. But no one can read it because it's behind like a $50 paywall. And the article is about openness. The article is about making the world a more open place. And so that's kind of frustrating. But then, you know, academics for a long time have tried to find ways around this. Things like ResearchGate have arisen, where we share maybe access to our articles. But even there have been recent lawsuits where ResearchGate is being held accountable for allowing people to circumvent copyright restrictions on scientific and academic knowledge. And in certain parts of the world, many parts of the world outside the United States, there's kind of this counterculture that's evolved. Like Sci-Hub is a great example of this, where you have scholars that are intentionally working against the academic publishing system to circumvent copyright, because to gain access to a $50 article in many parts of the world would be equal to like a week's worth of a week's salary. And so when we restrict knowledge in this way, we prevent learners across the world from gaining access to knowledge. And so this differentially impacts people in poorer countries. And this is all kind of a strange attitude to have toward knowledge. So what if, the question that I wonder is, what if academic publishing was a more generous system? And I'll explain what I mean by a generous system here in a second. Reverend Dr. William J. Barber II came and did a talk here at BYU a couple years ago. His big focus for a long time in his life has been on eliminating poverty. And one of the things that he says is that we do not have a scarcity of resources in the world, but we have is a scarcity of collective moral conscience. And when we think about, you know, how do I address the needs of the people around me? Often it's not an issue of resources. Often it's not an issue that we just don't have enough. So often the issue is that we haven't worked together to figure out how to provide those resources. And so an example of this is waste in the United States. So our landfills we have difficulty finding places for our garbage in the United States. We have lots of garbage and our landfills are full. The number one occupant of landfills is food. Not just food waste, but actual food, particularly produce. And so we have all this food being dumped into landfills, and it accounts for about 60% of methane emissions to the atmosphere from landfills. And why is this, when about a third of our population is experiencing food insecurity? Well, it's not a problem of resources because we have the food. So where is the problem? What is the problem? Well, you see things like food banks, for instance, and what they do is they connect those resources and the surplus to those who have need. And so it seems like a big part of what's the problem is that we lack sufficient infrastructure to connect surplus or resources that we have with the needs of the people around them. So similar kinds of systems that exist are like the American Red Cross. The Red Cross does not create blood. It does not generate blood, but it connects those who are willing to give blood and plasma to those who need it. Similarly, things like freecycle.org, if I just want to give away my dryer or TV, I can just put it on there and someone else who is in need of that can gain access to it in that way. So in all of these ways, these institutions, these organizations, they serve as connectors. They're connectors between surplus and need. They're not creators themselves. And so in that way, I think a generous system allows us to overcome want by creating connections. So these are systems based on generosity, and they work because they create connections between those who have and those who have not. I think there's this very similar to what Brian Stevenson has talked about. If you're familiar with Brian Stevenson, he wrote the book Just Mercy, which was later turned into a movie. He's a famous civil rights lawyer in the South. Has done a lot of work with wrongly incarcerated or to liberate wrongly incarcerated inmates on death row. But when he looks at the American system, specifically the criminal justice system, but I think it applies in a variety of ways. He argues that the problem that we're facing is like there are good people, there are people that are trying to do good things, but the problem is we're not close enough to one another. It's hard to, in his words, it's hard to make any, it's hard to make progress in social justice, for instance, if I live in a gated community and I'm not around people who are struggling. And so like his solution is, I'm going to go to the prison. I'm going to go talk to the people on death row so I can really understand what they're experiencing. And again, this says to me that if we are willing to be proximal to those in need, we're willing to make connection with those in need, that empowers us to do things that we otherwise would not be able to do. So a metaphor that I've come to like for all of this is the giving machine. And if you've seen these before, they pop up, especially around the holidays, the winter holidays in like big cities like Salt Lake and New York. But what they do is like if someone's walking to lunch, they see this, they can stop by it, and then they have the opportunity to buy a goat or chickens or a polio vaccine for someone on the other side of the world. This doesn't create polio vaccines, but what it does is it connects the surplus of one person with the needs of another. And I would say this is a generous system because it connects those two things together, whereas they would not have been connected before. So my question is, can we make academic publishing, learning design, knowledge sharing, all of this more generous, connected, and effective? Can we essentially do something similar to the giving machine or the food bank in academic publishing? And so I know you're all familiar with OER, and so I'm not going to talk at length about, you know, what this means, but I think that OER are a vehicle for doing this. When I, just for clarity and definitions, when I say OER, I mean things that are free as in cost, but also free as in freedom, meaning that they can be reused, revised, remixed, redistributed, and retained as in Wiley's five R's. And specifically, open textbooks is what I've predominantly been focusing on. Not exclusively open textbooks, but this seems to be the entry point for many people in how we can make the most change the most rapidly. So open textbooks specifically are free as in cost, they're free as in freedom, meaning you can remix them, change them, share them, and they're living so they can always be updated. You don't have to wait for the publisher to release a new version. So imagine if we had an academic publishing system where all knowledge is available without cost, so everyone has access to it. All learning materials can be freely shared, adapted, updated, and changed. I don't need your permission to use your syllabus. I don't need your permission to change this word or update this typo or to translate this thing that you created. Everyone has persistent and full access to everything. So once you graduate, you don't automatically lose access to all of your learning materials. Everyone can participate in knowledge creation. So it's not just white men at elite universities making these resources, and resources are higher quality than they were under a commercial model. So they're up to date, they're being improved by based on community feedback and those kinds of things. So, with that, I'm going to pivot a little bit, and let's talk about the textbook market. And first talk about like why we are where we are, why we have this kind of situation that we're in right now, and just so we can understand the situation, because most people don't understand how publishing in academia works, and they don't understand how the textbook market works. So let's just talk about this a little bit. So if you have a book like Harry Potter, if you go to buy it on Amazon, you can buy it for like $11. So it works out to like 3 cents per page. If you're like a collector, you want the hardback version, it's a little bit more expensive. And the digital version ends up being sometimes even more expensive than the paperback, but it's still fairly reasonable, right? You know, it's like $13 or 4 cents per page for digital page. In contrast, if you have a book that is a textbook, you'll often run into this situation. So this is a book that costs $140, about 35 cents per page. The digital version is $50, about 12 cents per page. And this is particularly interesting in this case because this is a book about equity, peace, and sustainability. And when I look at situations like this, I think, well, you know, we should know better. Like, because who can buy this book? Who can learn about equity, peace, and sustainability? Well, those who have access to funds, those who can pay $140 to read it. We should know better as scholars. And it doesn't just apply to, you know, niche areas like that, or social areas, but it applies to all aspects of scholarship. So if you think about basic knowledge, or knowledge that really hasn't changed in the last 100 years. So classical mechanics, for instance, or Newton's laws haven't changed in a while. Why do I require my students to pay for access to learn about those kinds of things when they could just go on now to Wikipedia or someplace else? And we're putting students in situations where they can either buy the textbook that contains knowledge that is non-copyrightable, by the way, and often dated or often hasn't changed or been updated in many years, or eat for a week. So from our students' perspective, this leads them to look at us as professors in kind of a villain aspect. And so I don't think that most professors are like this. There are some, I think, that are like this, that are using their position of power over their students to extort funds from them. But I think for the most part, we're not. But we're in the system where it's just kind of the norm of this is how we operate. And so let's try to understand the market of what, how this is a market, or if this is even a market. Because sometimes whenever I talk about this, people will say things like, Royce, are you anti-capitalist? Are you anti, I don't know, anti-market, or you're destroying economic systems? Or like, no, but this is not a market. The problem here, so first let's try to understand what a market is. So in a market economy, the consumer decides what they want to buy. They then pay for it. They then own it. So in the case of Harry Potter, this is what's happening. This is why the cost of a Harry Potter book is reasonable, because if they try to make the cost of a Harry Potter book too high, people just wouldn't buy it. Versus in a command economy, the government decides, the government pays, and the government owns whatever is created. The current textbook market is kind of this unholy, weird combination of the two, where universities are deciding what must be purchased. Students are paying for it. And increasingly, students don't even own it after they pay for it. The publishers own it, especially when, as things have moved more digital rights management, publishers own it after the student pays for it, and then the student loses access to it. So universities are not affected by costs. Publishers benefit from high costs, and students cannot influence costs. So this is not a market in any meaningful sense of the word, because students have no influence over the market. And this is especially apparent when you look at like the existence of international editions of textbooks. So publishers make agreements with textbook with their distributors that they cannot sell international editions of their books within the United States. But the reason they have international editions is because if they create a psychology book that costs $150, people in Indonesia are not going to buy that book, or in India. And so they create a cheaper version of it, which actually is often the exact same book. It just has a different cover on it. Exact same content, often exact same production value, but it ends up being half or a third of the cost. But they make agreements with their distributors that they cannot sell these cheaper versions inside the United States, because in order to drive up their profits. And so you don't see this in other markets. And this is just an indicator this is not a true market, because they are leveraging their power over students to extract more funds from them than would otherwise be reasonable. So let's just think through a scenario. Let's imagine I'm a seasoned expert in biology and I want to make an edited volume representing the work of the leaders in my field to be used in the intro to biology class. So I want to write a textbook, or I want to create a book that my students could use. What are the kind of pathways for me to do that? So if spreadsheets put you to sleep, sorry, there are just going to be a couple of these. But this is just to help us understand exactly how costs move through this system, or who actually makes money through this. So if I'm this biology expert, if I want to write this book, I end up I'm being paid by my university to do this. I'm not receiving additional funds, but my university is paying my salary. So it's part of my teaching or my citizenship that I'm doing this. I then ask other authors to be involved, serve as authors of chapters or as reviewers. They're all donating their time, but ultimately it's their university that's donating their time, because the university is paying them to do this kind of work. And then, you know, in addition, the university is paying overhead in terms of providing computers to these people, power, and so forth. So for a book like this, university would be investing over $50,000 to make this happen. The publisher, on the other hand, takes this work that is being done by these authors, and they will layer on top of it copy editing, web hosting, all those kinds of registration for DOI, indexing, and so forth. They'll create a cover, they'll do marketing work with it, and then they'll print it, and then I put overhead costs there as well. So but they end up investing about the same amount as the university does overall, about $50,000. And just to verify this is accurate, you know, recently my colleague, he went through the process of creating an entire edited volume, and then he went to a publisher and said, okay, this is great, but we want to release it open access. And they said, that would be fine, but you have to pay us $30,000 to make that happen. So what that tells me is that the publisher is, that was kind of their upper limit of how much they were planning on investing in this is $30,000. Or what they were expecting to make out of it. They've done surveys with publishers, and they find publishers tend to spend between $10,000 and $100,000 on volumes that they create with scholars. And almost all of that, or most of that, is spent on acquisitions and marketing. So it's not actually improving the content or verifying its quality or anything like that. It's in the acquisitions aspect of it. So we go through all that process. Afterwards, the original author, the main author, receives a royalty check of about 15%, between 5 and 15%. 15% is the upper limit of the net, profit from it. So in this case, it'd be about $2,000 total if the book sold 1,000 copies. So at the end of this, you see the university pays $50,000, the publisher makes $20,000, the lead author makes $2,000, and the students pay $75,000 for the system to work. Another approach, so that's the first option available to this biology professor. Another approach would be to do a digital-only version where there is no printing cost. It's very similar structure. The only difference is that the publisher is not having to pay for the physical printing of content. They just have to post it online, which is actually very inexpensive. But all that really changes in this model, the university still pays the same amount. The publisher puts forth less because they're not publishing it physically. Their profits end up being a lot higher as a result. In addition, because they can manage access to it more granularly, students do not have the ability, for instance, to buy used versions of it. They do not have the ability to share with their peer or those kinds of things. So what happens when you move to a digital publishing model is that more students have to buy the book, but often the selling point that the publisher gives you is, we'll make it cheaper. Well, they make it about 30% cheaper, but if they can increase the number that they sell, in this case, if they double it, by requiring every student to gain access to it, then they actually increase their profits as a result. And so in this case, students are spending even more. They're spending about $100,000 on this, even though the cost of the book actually goes down. The publisher is making more. The author is making more. Again, the contributing authors and universities don't receive anything from any of this. Now, there's this term inclusive access, and I'm assuming many of you already know, have heard of this or know what this is. This is a fairly new development, but it's a really problematic one in publishing, because the idea behind it is that, you know, we recognize that students coming into our classes need access to textbooks, so we can either require them to go and buy the textbook from the bookstore, but they may not get it in time, or they may be waiting for it to arrive from Amazon or something like that. So what if, instead of having them buy the textbook, we charge them a flat fee at the beginning of the year, and that ensures that they have access to it on day one. Therefore, it's inclusive of they're paying this fee that is inclusive of their access to the materials. Well, to kind of answer like why this is a problem, we use a parable. So we already said that if students are in a K-12 setting or coming to school having not eaten, then they have difficulty learning. We recognize that, then the problem seems to be, well, okay, we can't have hungry kids in our school. So what is our solution? Well, an inclusive access solution would be, we're just going to charge all of our kids before they come into school, and we don't let them come into our classroom until they've paid this fee so that they can eat. And does it solve the problem? Well, yeah, it keeps hungry kids out of our schools, but it solves the problem by being exclusionary, by kicking them out, by not letting them come in unless they pay the fee. This is how inclusive access works in higher ed. So it's not that we are providing more access to more students, but we're only allowing students to even come to our classes if they have paid the fee that allows them to be there for the material. And that's a problem, I think. So in my view, digital publishing and inclusive access models are actually worse than the traditional print model for these reasons. It costs our students more, they can't sell the books back, they don't own them, and the publisher ends up making even more off of it. The third option is to do a university-based open textbook. And this is my last spreadsheet. So if you've fallen asleep, wake up again. So in this model, we kind of just remove the publisher altogether. The university takes on the role of the publisher. They do the web hosting, DOI registration, cover design, all that kind of stuff. They actually end up not paying a lot more for this. It's about a 10% increase over what they were already investing into their faculty salaries for creating this kind of thing. But it can provide a 100% decrease to students in terms of how much the students are paying. So faculty then, if we're trying to decide which of these three roads should we go, we need to ask ourselves, would giving up that $2,000 royalty check be worth providing my students a $75,000 scholarship? For me, that's kind of a no-brainer. Of course, that makes a lot of sense. But also, this just assumes that the book is actually picked up and sold. And it's actually sold. Otherwise, the opportunity cost is zero. And often what you see happening when people go through a traditional publishing route, they'll get their book published and then no one buys it. Or 10 years later, it's just dead and no one's using it. And now it's just, it's no longer published. It's no longer accessible to anyone. And the original author can't even use it. They can't even make new copies of it. And you can't find it in a bookstore. Universities should be asking, would investing this additional 10% be worth providing $75,000 or $100,000 scholarship to our students? I think that again is a no-brainer. If I go to my chair and say, if our department can come up with $5,000, we can provide $100,000 scholarship to our students, that's a pretty powerful thing to be able to say, especially because the bulk of that additional cost that we're investing can go towards student salaries for work study and experiential study. So like the copy editing work and those kinds of things can be done by students. And that's actually what we do in our department. So with all of this as a background, this is why we've been focusing on what we've been doing with EdTech Books. EdTech Books is an open publishing platform that I created where colleagues and I have been, you know, publishing our materials. This has now morphed into a bunch of sister sites that all use a common code base, common data that are specialized for specific universities. So BYU has its own open.byu.edu, BYU Idaho has its own books.byui.edu. And so the idea is that if I'm creating stuff for my field on EdTech Books, or I'm creating stuff for my university at open.byu.edu, we can share those resources between those two, and people can gain access to them from everywhere. And so open textbooks are not a new thing. They've been around for at least 20 years, but they haven't taken off the way that I think they should have, or I would hope that they would have. Current surveys on this show that about 90% of faculty think that open textbooks are a great idea, but less than like 7% actually do them. There are a lot of reasons for this that we can talk about later, but it tells me that someone who thinks like a designer, someone who thinks about things like about these problems in terms of like design solutions, that we have to redesign how we're actually doing open textbooks to make them more usable for people. And so I agree, Blake Ross is one of the founders of Mozilla. He said the next big thing is the one that makes the last big thing usable. Just like in many ways, Tesla did this. So electric cars have been around for a long time, but then Tesla came around and actually made them usable for the mass market, similar to iPhones. Smartphones have been around for a while. The original iPhone actually didn't have any new features over like what Nokia or others had. They just made it more usable, and that's why it took off. So an example of what we've done, this is a Design for Learning textbook. This is an edited peer-reviewed volume that we've published. It includes the work of about 60 authors. Like, John, you're an author on one of these chapters, right? From 35 institutions. These are leaders in the field. This book is over 400 pages. At the end of every chapter, there's something like a five-star, similar to like a five-star Amazon rating. The readers will review it. And so it has a high quality rating score. It's all designed to be mobile friendly. They're built in dictionary. So you highlight any term, it'll give you a definition of the term. There are free web versions, audiobooks, PDF downloads, Microsoft Word downloads. It's always being updated as well. So like if there's an error, they can go and fix it. And there are no logins or paywalls. And this particular one as well is also printed through Amazon. So you can get free Amazon Prime shipping on it. So to contrast this back with the example that I gave at the beginning, this Design for Learning book is printed for $14, about 3 cents per page. And you get free Amazon shipping through it. If you're a Prime member, the digital version is free for all these different formats. In contrast, this, and I'm not picking on this particular textbook for any reason, this is just an example, but this is because this is the norm. So we end up being about a tenth of the cost for the print version, and the digital version is better, more accessible, and you have a lot more features and opportunities with it. So this is what we've been doing. So EdTech Books is a platform for creating these kinds of and sharing these kinds of books. So my pattern now that I follow in my classes when I'm teaching is if I'm going to teach a class, I go and actually create an open book for that class. So this is an example of the educational technology handbook that I use in my undergrad tech integration courses. The book is mobile accessible. You can embed it directly into your learning management system. So most of the time when students are using the book, they don't even realize they're using it. It just fits directly into their natural learning experience, and they don't have to log into a separate system or anything like that. And this book is embedded in learning management systems by universities all over the world. So students, you know, in lots of different states and countries are accessing the content, and they all have equal access to the resources. It's designed to be mobile first. It's following modern web design practices in that regard. It's provided in multiple formats, not just a PDF. Most OER out there, the default is to provide a PDF. But the problem with the PDF is that it can be shared easily, but it can't be remixed or revised. That's why we provide things in Microsoft Word, HTML formats, and also audiobooks. We're providing everything as a free audiobook as well. And I'm finding increasingly students use this constantly. So like if they're riding the bus and they need to do their reading for the day, they'll just turn on the audiobook and they'll listen to it that way. We also provide lots of resources and tools for creators. So if you like my textbook or you like a chapter in my textbook, you can just click a couple buttons. You can copy those over to your own textbook. You can remix it, reorder it, and it'll do the citations for you and all that kind of thing. And then it also will provide with you analytics data on how it's being used, who's using it, what universities are linking to it, and all that kind of stuff. In addition, I think there's some really exciting pedagogical practices that can be incorporated into this. So this is an example of an open textbook that is a living volume that is constantly being updated every year that I teach a writing course. But this book was created. So that students in my introductory writing class would have an authentic experience of writing something that for others to read. And so this book is intended, it covers basic topics in learning design and technology written by students for students. So things like constructivism. But the cool thing about this is because these are published and they're indexed by Google Scholar, they're then cited. And so like, for instance, this student who recently graduated with her PhD, if you look at her Google Scholar profile, the things that I've highlighted there are all articles that she's written on EdTech Books that have been cited by other scholars. I've done this multiple times, lots of different settings. So we also, so the last time I taught that writing course, we wrote a book together. And that was kind of stressful for my students, but we did it. And you can search for 50 years of education research trends and you'll find it. But this is a full volume analyzing 50 years of academic articles of scholarly articles in the field of education to try to understand what's been happening over the years. So as my colleagues have looked at this, they've said some really positive things about it. And so these are not the open ed community kind of has its own, sorry, my computer's freaking out. The open ed community kind of has its own group of folks that are really passionate about open education and things. But then, you know, the traditional scholar, and I say traditional, but like the hardcore like researchers, they also look at this and they think, well, this is actually really powerful. So like think about Tom Reeves here says, I can't think of a more valuable resource than the tech books in his 5 decades in the field. Matt Schmidt over here, he is doing cutting edge work with augmented reality and helping learners on the autism spectrum. But this has become his go-to place for finding resources for his class and publishing his own resources. And Albert Ritzopt here is the editor of one of the top journals in our field. He said that this has already had a profound influence in our field. And we've only been doing this for about 5 years. So in EdTech books, we have some example. I have some examples here. Our books, they range from everything from educational technology to democracy and education. We also publish a journal now, the Journal of Applied Instructional Design, which is an AECT-sponsored journal. And this, because there's been such interest, we've also branched out into other areas as well. So like the open.byu.edu site is an example of this. So because we have a lot of BYU folks wanting to do this kind of work, but they would really been under the ed tech umbrella. So we branched out to that. Also don't have it here, but equitypress.org is another one that we have that we're using in that regard. And BYU Idaho is producing all kinds of materials now on their site. Some of these books are 2,000 pages long. I mean, they have just so much content. And they're just putting tons of content and time and resources into this. And so in looking at this, what we've within the system, it'll also predict the cost savings that you're providing to your students based upon usage of your book. But from this, we estimate that our books have saved students about $4 million each year. That here at BYU, that's equivalent to about 100 bachelor's degrees. So that's a big deal. That's a big scholarship. Since October 2018, we have published 172 books by 315 authors. It's over 13,000 printable pages. So we estimate we've saved students about $12 million over that time. That's equivalent to about 15,000 students' food for a semester, health insurance for 35,000 students, tuition for 300 bachelor's degrees. Now, to compare, what has this cost us? Well, if I want to publish in a traditional journal, if I do a research study, I get it published in a traditional journal, I want to make that open access, the publisher will typically charge me between $3,500 and $5,000, depending on the journal. But the upper end that I've seen is typically about $5,000. For $5,000, that's how much it's cost us to host these servers for 5 years. So we've been able to do all this, and the tech part of it has only cost us about $5,000. In addition, our students in our department now, in our master's and PhD department programs here at BYU and in IP&T, pay $0 for required MA and PhD materials. They just don't have to pay anything. There are some electives that they take that they still have to buy like a $15 or $40 textbook for, but by and large, they don't pay anything. And for me, the most exciting part of all this is that it connects all of our institutions together. So like I create stuff for my courses here at BYU, but then what's really exciting is then when I go onto the site and I see, well, this is being used at the University of Minnesota or at University of Memphis, or I didn't even know Baker University existed. Oh, that's very cool. They're using these resources. And so they're ways of allowing us to collaborate that we wouldn't otherwise have had. It also allows us to share in ways that we wouldn't have been able to before. This is an email that I just got a couple days ago, last week, where a professor had been working at BYU Idaho. He was using a textbook there. Now he went to another institution and he wants to continue to use the textbook. Said, what do I need to do to make this happen? Well, you don't have to do anything. You just keep using it because it's open. And if you want to make a remix of it, I can help you do that. But technically, like part of how we make this work is that when you create a resource, so say you create something on EdTech Books, if we want to cross-list it on another site, all we have to do is flip a switch, and then it shows up on the BYU site or the BYU Idaho site or Equity Press. And we just make this really simple so that it can be cross-listed in these different institutions. So for me now, open means both free and higher quality than a commercial approach. So these open resources are more up-to-date. They allow for more supplemental resources, more variations than what we could do, so we can automatically level, localize, translate the resources. There's more freedom for course designers and pulling resources and using them. There are more opportunities for using things like AI, cross-site tools, embedding multimedia, and we can collaborate more effectively with these resources. In addition, research has shown that by doing this, there are other economic benefits that come from it. So it decreases time to graduation, decreases course dropout rates, increases course enrollment. Oftentimes students will sign up for a course and they'll see the cost of the textbook and they'll drop that course. This prevents that from happening. Also studies have shown that when students have to buy an expensive textbook, the first part of their budget that goes is their grocery budget, and the second part is their healthcare. And so this allows them to eat more healthy and to take care of their health needs. So I know I'm running short on time, but I do want to address some of the myths that are kind of preventing this kind of work from moving forward. The first is that you get what you pay for. And I hear this a lot from folks. In contrast, when people come to ed tech books, like I've heard multiple times people say things like, well, these don't look like open textbooks. That makes me feel good, but at the same time, it makes me frustrated because we've equated open with lower quality. And so to kind of wrap our heads around this mentality doesn't really work in education. So for instance, if you look at the average debt for students graduating from an unranked for-profit university, and I haven't put their names here, but these are two universities that we would all know, they're owing $30,000 to $40,000 versus student graduates from BYU, they owe about $11,000. Student graduates from Princeton, they're owing about $12,000. And so you could look at this and say, oh, those poor Princeton students, they must not be getting a very good education because they're owing less than students graduating from this for-profit university. Well, no, that's just not true. In fact, just last week, a wealthy donor donated $1 billion to Bronx Medical School, the Albert Einstein Medical School in the Bronx, so the students there will never have to pay tuition again. So no one thinks, oh, that those poor medical students, now they're going to get a terrible education because they're not having to pay for it. And the truth is that each of us immeasurably benefits from the generosity of others every day. So like when philanthropy is involved, when giving is involved, we always get much, much more than we pay for. And we look at the quality of these resources. I don't have time to go through all this, but like looking at lots of different metrics, we see that the quality of these resources are much higher than what our students had access to begin with. Our books are receiving all kinds of awards, including like the ACT Outstanding Book Award. We now have over 27,000 ratings on our content from readers on the site, and the overall rating is of high quality. And then ultimately, if you just ask any of our students, they'll tell you. There is a website, openedgroup.org. This is a great place to go to see what the research actually shows about open resources. And it's actually kind of boring in my mind, because it's clear and it's obvious. But if you go and look through the research on OER, the same result comes up over and over and over again. And it is always that students who are using open textbooks or OER perform equal to or better than those using commercial counterparts. And so it's a no-brainer in my mind. There is not a quality question. The second is, well, money is the best motivator. How are you going to get faculty to create these resources or remix these resources if there's not a financial benefit to it? Well, the truth is that we do this all the time anyway. So I've published probably about 100 traditionally published articles and encyclopedia articles and those kinds of things over the years. I haven't been paid anything for any of that. So why did I do any of that? Well, because it's part of my job, and because I'm trying to contribute to knowledge. So the truth is, especially in academia, money's power as a motivator is overstated and highly contextual. And when we see those numbers actually laid out, I see, well, I could get a $2,000 royalty check, or I could save my students $75,000. That $2,000 is much less of a motivator at that point. In fact, what I've seen happen is that has been pleasantly surprising to me is actually a lot of scholars who are near the end of their careers are really investing their time into creating these resources. And it's because they've published traditionally before, and it has not provided to them the benefit that they were hoping it would, either financially or having the impact that they wanted. And so now that they're at the end of their careers, they're having a bit of like an existential crisis, and they want to, like, how can I leave lasting impact on the field or a legacy on the field? And the answer is to create an open resource so they can have a greater impact on learners. Third myth is that openness is not sustainable. That's just patently not true. Most of the software you use on a daily basis is based on open codes. Whenever you go to a website or open an app on your phone, most of the code that's running in the background, 70 to 90% of it is openly licensed. And so the truth is that open is sustainable. It may look a little bit different, but it's doable and it's deeply valuable. If we did not have open software, for instance, we would not have the internet. We would not have our modern smartphones. And so openness is essential, and it is sustainable, but it does operate a little bit differently than some of our other models. But just to give you an idea of this, part of how we've made ed tech books sustainable is by making it inexpensive to host. And so this is just from the our last month's use. Last month, we served content to over 150,000 users. And that cost us about less than $100. So for every dollar that we spend, we give access to about 1,700 people for an entire month. So that seems pretty sustainable to me. That's not a huge cost. And the last myth, and this is probably the most tragic myth of all, is that I don't have anything to give. So how can I contribute to this, to any of this, because I'm just a lecturer, just a faculty member, or this or that. But the truth is that less than 7% of the world's population has an equivalent of a BA or a BS. And so that means that the vast majority of people working at universities are much more highly educated and know much, much more than they realize. And so each of us has superhero level knowledge and skills that we can provide to the world around us. And what EdTech books or other projects like this allow us to do is just provide that connector so that we can't put money into the machine, but we can put our knowledge and our skills into the machine and then allow others to benefit from it. So what is the future? I hope the future is something that is more connected and open, where we can connect the work that's being done at BYU or at BYU Idaho or Idaho State University or anywhere else together, so that all of our students can benefit from the work that each of us are putting forward to doing these kinds of things. And so that's my presentation. Thank you all so much for listening, and I'll stop there. Sorry, my computer's freaking out.
It looks like John may have had to leave, but thank you for presenting today. It's actually quite inspiring. I think that last point that you made, the myth of, oh, I don't have anything to give. I think that's something I struggle with, but it's encouraging to hear you provide some refutation to that, I suppose. But I teach an information literacy class that's Introduction to Information Research. I use a textbook that costs about $20 for a paperback. And I think students can get an ebook version for maybe $10 or $15 or something. And then I also require the APA manual, which, you know, students do need to document sources, and that's part of the class. So I don't know. I'm just trying to think. I know that there are some information literacy textbooks out there. It does take some work to go out and look for those things. But, you know, it is curious, after teaching for 5 or 10 years, sometimes you internalize a lot more than you realize about what you've learned. And so I suppose it is possible. The struggle is getting that motivation to write and the confidence to write and doing some of those kinds of things. But I did put in the chat, you know, authors can negotiate their copyright restrictions for their articles. But, you know, I think a lot of professors aren't trained to even think about that. You know, when they submit an article to a journal, it's right. Possible that you can negotiate. But if you're just for an example, if you're a new professor that's, you know, not tenured yet, you've got that pressure to publish so that you can keep your job, right? So anyway.
Sorry, 1 second. My computer is going nuts. Okay, sorry, I'm back. Yeah, thanks, Spencer. Some great points. Yeah, so I don't know. My experience with publishing has been, again, and I've published a lot of stuff. There really isn't. I mean, there are some ways that you can like host your like a pre-publication version of your research on your institution repository or those kinds of things. Again, like you say, professors aren't typically trained in even to think through that. In terms of negotiating, I've never seen that really be an option. But like with the major publishers, like they have their expectations for you giving your copyright over to them, and there is no negotiation with that. But again, all my publishing has been mainly journal articles rather than like full book. But when negotiation has been a part, negotiation means money. And so like what I have seen in terms of when publishers are willing to negotiate, there's always quite a bit of money involved. So I gave the example of, okay, we'll publish your book, but pay us $30,000 and then we'll make it open licensed. Or your article, give us $3,500 or $5,000 and we'll make it open licensed. And so from my experience, they tend to rely on the boilerplate copyright expectations unless you're bringing a lot of money to the table or you're willing to do that.
Have you ever asked them if, like, if you could, after it's published, get it just posted to your institutional repository? Would they charge you money for that too?
They absolutely would. Yeah. Most of the time, when they allow you to do it, they only allow you to do a preprint version of it, one that haven't gone through final copy editing, because they want to ensure that the version they're providing is higher quality in some way.
Yeah.
But yeah, and most of the time when you're publishing an article, you're not interacting with the publisher yourself, as like an author. You're interacting with the editor, so the editor is interacting with the publisher, and so like when I'm getting something published, I'm getting it going through the editor, and the editor is saying, well, this is the policy with the publisher, and the publisher will not allow us to. And so they'll just say, well, if you're going to be a problematic author, we'll just reject it, because these journals have a 5% acceptance rate anyway, and so like they're not going to want to deal with you if you're being problematic in that way. I don't
Yeah.
know. John's an editor on one of these journals now, so I don't know if
Yeah,
he wants to refute anything that I'm saying, but
is the publishing industry. That's how they operate, so.
I will put a link in the chat. So like the APA manual is one that I was requiring my st like the only book that I was requiring my students to buy for a long time, but I no longer do that. And partially because I found that I created a one page job aid that addressed the vast majority of it looks like I can only send it to you directly, Spencer, but that would address the vast majority of yeah, I could share my screen, errors that I was seeing in student writing. And so 90% of the things that my students struggle with are the questions they have about APA, I've addressed in this one pager. And so between that and Purdue OWL, I no longer feel like I need to require them to buy that manual.
Well, thank you for sharing that. Laura did have one more question. Do you have time for one more question?
Yeah, I have time.
I am curious. Thank you. This has been really informative, and I have a lot to digest now. And thank you for sharing your slides. I really, really appreciate this presentation. I have a question about how BYU, or maybe you are familiar with other schools and how they're interacting with the bookstore. With open education resources being printed, we're
Yeah.
using press books, and there's that option. When we have a course, then we put, yes, we have OER, and but I think there's some miscommunication happening about with students understanding that when they see that, they don't really know that it's OER and that yes, it's freely available, and then they buy it, not realizing that they're just getting the printed version.
Right.
And I don't know if that's actually true across the whole board. I'm still trying to understand the process as a new
Yeah.
faculty member.
I don't think it is. I don't think that's normal. But so bookstores have been in a precarious situation the past few years. They themselves have had to deal with that identity crisis because of so much has moved to digital. And so you see a lot of bookstores even being rebranded as like university store or something like that for that reason, because they're no longer books have become no longer their primary source of revenue, and they see a future where maybe that isn't even where their funds are coming from. So I guess all that's to say bookstores are in upheaval, and they have been for a while. And because of that, there is kind of a weird relationship with OER. But each institution kind of navigates it differently. Like Like for us, yeah, I have to go on every semester and say my students don't have to purchase anything, but then the bookstore doesn't provide them links or any to the materials. It just tells them they don't have to buy anything. And then when they start my Canvas course, then they see the link to the materials. So there, I have also seen tensions where even with OER, sometimes bookstores want to take over as the sole or primary provider of any print versions of those OER because they want that revenue stream. So like I've been on campuses where like one of the slides that I said, so you could print this on Amazon and get it with Prime shipping for $14. And they said, oh, don't say that because we want them to print through our bookstore and we'll charge $25 or something like that. So I think that's a tension you see at some universities. But yeah, each university is kind of its own animal in that regard. And I think, as a faculty member, I mean, yeah, I mean, you have to operate within the university that you're in, but by and large with the bookstore, I think that just means telling them that you're not, that there are no required materials to publish, and then making sure that you are communicating with your students as early as possible so that they know that they don't need to purchase anything. And so like, I often will send an email to my students even a week or two before class. Granted, not everyone has signed up for the class yet, and so I might have to send it again later. But also put it like front and center on my syllabus and front and center on my course that here's the link to the textbook. So you don't have to worry about buying anything.
Excellent. Thank you. Thank you. That's been a point of confusion for me.
Do we have any other questions for Royce? All right, man, once again, you killed it. Sorry, my computer crashed on me right there at the end. So if you said something different and I missed it, you're going to have to tell me. But
okay. No, mine's been freaking out too. Thank you. Appreciate that.
Yeah. So, yeah, on behalf of ISU and the OER committee, and thanks for being the keynote for Open Ed Week, man. Appreciate it. Look.
Yeah. Thank you so much. Appreciate all of you. Appreciate the work that you do. And please, if you have questions, feel free to reach out or anything I can help with. Love to chat more.
Okay. Thanks, everyone.
Thanks, everyone.
We'll see y'all.
Thank you.